for those who haven't been stalking me for the last 2 days, like a couple of these guys, my name's Kerry Garrison. I'm the COO of Multicopter Warehouse. We're a dealer distributor based in Colorado. And one of my big passions that gets me up in the every morning and makes me love what I do is developing products and solutions for search and rescue. It is something that hits very close to home for me. We have too many deaths every year in Colorado. That can be averted, that can be saved. This past spring, in just the span of 2 weeks, we had 4 teenagers fall through thin ice. 3 of them died because there was literally no way to get to them. The ice was too thin to put down the ladders to distribute the weight, but it was still too thick to get a boat through. And the first responders on the scene literally stood on the shore watching teenagers die. This doesn't have to happen. We have solutions, we have technology, we have ways of preventing that. And that is one of my missions in life, is to develop those things in conjunction with our manufacturing partners to prevent that from ever happening. We have elderly that walk away from the homes and are lost and succumb to the elements. We have hikers that are up on the mountains that get stuck in a storm and all they need is a thermal blanket or something to get through the night until a rescue team can get there to save them. So part of the mission, as I understand it, from working with the guys out in the field who are doing search and rescue, is that I don't have the ability to save somebody. I don't have the ability to technically save a life. What I have is the ability to extend survivability long enough for you guys to go out and rescue them. You're the ones that are saving lives. I'm just a tool. I have a tool that can help in that mission. So by extending survivability, that is my goal in developing systems for search and rescue. Does that kind of make sense? That's what you guys, people like you, told me. Some of the typical missions that we have: lost persons, that's a biggie, stranded hikers, disaster reconnaissance, and fire monitoring. Those are, you know, the big typical missions. This particular picture was taken down in Texas during the floods, where people were just lost everywhere. And they were flying all over the place and locating all these people that were stuck in different coves. People who had no boats or means of even staying afloat, they were able to fly out and drop life preservers right in their hands. Again, extending survivability long enough for the rescuers to get there and save them. Some of the more advanced missions that we're just starting to see is delivery of emergency supplies. Developing drop systems that can put the equipment in their hands to get through the immediate need or overnight. Thermal blankets, medicine, water, a radio, whatever that need be. As I mentioned, the actually dropping life preservers into people's hands. Last summer, this was down in Texas as well during the floods, and they were using an Inspire to take out a lead line so that then the people could pull in a rope and get pulled out to safety. And they credited that particular aircraft right there with saving 12 lives. They were able to get a line out to people who were stuck in boats, pull them in, get them right out of the river a lot more effectively than any other tool in their disposal. So this ability to deliver stuff, besides pizza and beer, which we all know is fantastic, emergency supplies is huge. For those of you who haven't been in any of my talks the last couple days, if you have questions as we go, feel free, raise your hand. I prefer to be as interactive as possible. If there's a question that's relevant, that lets just hit it right there instead of you trying to remember a question until the very end. So I kind of like the interactive approach when I'm up here just babbling for no apparent reason. Some of the future missions that we see This particular picture is a resuscitator. I mean, it's they can actually deliver a machine to somebody to do, to save their life right there on the spot, deliver the shock right to someone. It flies in, it's got a handle on it, it's got a camera, and it has a speaker, so it can land, someone can grab it, take it in, pull the paddles out, and be walked through the procedure by somebody remotely who's watching that through the camera that's on the copter. Cell phone detectors are just starting to hit, and even if there's no cell signal, those detectors can find those cell phones. This is very handy in situations like avalanches. So within minutes after an avalanche, copters can be in the air and start locating people who are under the snow without having to send teams up there and dogs up there and, you know, having to rely on someone having had the forethought to put an avalanche beacon on before they went up in the snow. If they have a cell phone, they can be found now. This is a huge advantage. Same with hikers, just people who are missing right off of a trail. As long as they had a cell phone on them, these detectors are now getting to the point where it's extremely useful. This past, about several months ago, up on the Appalachian Trail, this 60-year-old woman had been, her life's dream was to hike the Appalachian Trail. She went missing for 6 months. She survived up until 2 weeks before her body was found. She was out there by herself for 6 months. She was found a half mile from the trail. The sheriff's department refused to let anybody take a UAV up to try and locate her, insisting that dogs were the answer. That is the technology. Not this drone crazy stuff, you know, dogs. Well, you'd think after a couple days, weeks, months, maybe it wasn't working out so well. And we lost a life on the Appalachian Trail when a copter with a thermal camera would have found her probably within an hour or two. So there's a lot of resistance in using the technology because this is the way it's always been done. And that attitude needs to change. We're seeing high intensity lights being put on so that had we even been up in the air and not been able to find her, she would have seen the beacon in the air and been able to follow it out to safety. As simple as that, a Phantom with just its built-in navigation lights probably would have saved her life. So, again, I will harp on that we have the technology, we have the tools, they're just not being used very well. Some of the add-ons that we're starting to put together are drop systems, as I mentioned, with the medical supplies. For that situation back at home where we lost three teenagers this year, I'm working with DGI on their large Matrice 600 to develop a system that will drop a life ring that's attached to a rope. Within minutes, we can be out over that victim, put a life ring in their hands, and pull them out to safety, instead of watching them die from the shore. That's not, to me, a good alternative, you know? FLIR cameras, I actually just finished a talk, some of you were in there, talking about thermal imaging cameras. That is a huge increase in our ability to find lost people. I had never worked with a thermal camera before, and are we in September still, right? So a year ago, in October, I'm taking my first day off in like 6 months from work, and I get a phone call, 8-year-old girl's horse is missing. We gotta go help. It's local, this horse, this is gonna sound funny, I know. But the horse was kind of a celebrity, it's like 30 years old, it's been in every parade in the town, it's carried senators, congresspeople, actors, you know, it's just this famous horse, and it belongs to this 8-year-old, and it's missing, and it's been 3 days. And if that horse is not found soon, it's gonna die because it needs special medication and diet. So we go out, where they thought the horse might be, and we don't find anything. And in just talking about it with the owners, they have an 880-acre property, which is a big, big space to search. We go out first thing in the morning, so there's a good difference in temperature, and in less than 30 minutes, the horse was on its way back to the barn. We found it underneath the scrub brush. They had flown over it with other drones, couldn't find it, but a thermal camera found it almost immediately. So that ability to find horses, people, is huge when it comes to search and rescue. Being able to get out there and see that heat signature is making a huge difference in our abilities out there. New high-intensity lighting systems for nighttime flying, being able to locate people through the bush, you know, underneath canopies and things, but also as a beacon that they can follow out to safety. Now, one problem that we are seeing in these types of things is with children, they tend to hide. They're kind of ingrained with, you know, stranger danger, and they actually tend to hide from search parties, which makes life a little more difficult. But at least we can spot them now, and we can get to them easier, even though they may see a copter in the sky and try and hide under a tree. The thermal camera allows us to see them and get them recovered. Lots of different upcoming sensor systems are being developed for deeper penetration through snow, through humidity, through other types of problems that we have today. Thermal cameras don't like water vapor. They can't work in rain, heavy snow, they can't work in fog. So we have problems with those. There's other systems that are coming, as I mentioned, the cell phone detectors, avalanche beacons, other types of sensors that are gonna be able to detect different types of electronic equipment and be able to locate it. So some of the common platforms that are in use are off-the-shelf systems. They're affordable, there's parts available, they're easy to fly. There's a ton of advantages to just taking something right off the shelf. It's gonna have a lower training curve and parts availability. So there's a lot of advantages to going off the shelf. As we start moving into custom products, larger platforms, the cost goes up. There may be a steeper learning curve. They are sometimes more difficult to fly because of the flight controllers that are on them. And it's harder to get something past an approval process when you can't really talk about what happens when there's a crash. How is that thing going to get repaired? What about having a backup system? So off-the-shelf products are making big inroads in this type of operation simply because of all the advantages. We started with the Phantom 2s, with FPV systems, being able to mount FLIR cameras to them, to Phantom 3s and Phantom 4s that are daylight specific, to the Inspire, the Matrice 100 and 600, where we can mount the thermal cameras to them. That particular copter there is the one that was used in Texas during all those rescue operations. The advantages, as I started to mention, the lower cost, availability of parts, community development. That can be a big one. With the DJI products, there's an open software development kit that allows third parties to write applications that can increase the utility of the products. So if I'm having to do a very large search pattern, I can turn to a third-party app like Map Pilot or Drone Deploy and create a search pattern that it will automatically fly. With Drone Deploy and a thermal camera attached, I can even set a temperature alert so that if while it's automatically flying that pattern, if it detects that particular temperature range, it will halt and hover so that I can then do a closer inspection of that particular heat source. So if I'm looking for a person and I set that temperature range to say 90 to 100 degrees, let it go, all of a sudden it freezes, an alert goes off, and I'm like, hey, I think we found something, versus having to sit there and stare at a screen and hope that I see it. So these automated tools are definitely making things a lot easier for us. And again, going back to the off-the-shelf solutions, we have utilities like this versus having to custom make stuff or it just isn't even possible on other platforms. In most of the systems, you have local dealer support. Well, if you're in Colorado, here I am, you know, I'm right there. but we also, you know, support people around the country. And your training costs are going to be lower because it's a standard product. A lot of training material is already out there for off-the-shelf systems. You guys are a very quiet crowd, I gotta say. Yes. It's called isotherm. Yeah. So isotherm allows that heat range detection. And the software that will do the automated pattern search and look for those heat ranges is called drone deploy. Or is it just like before lunch, you're just kind of tired, no one's asking questions? Yeah. It's brand new. Yeah, it was just announced a couple weeks ago. He said he's familiar with drone deploy, but didn't know about that particular feature, and it was because they just announced it. So I don't even know if it's in the public version yet, but it's in the version that I have. So on the, I mean, I'm always on the beta of stuff, so it may not have been rolled out publicly yet, but it was announced on their website. So it's the only one that I know of that actually has that at this point, or at least in development at some point. Yeah. Having multiple drones on a mission. So there's been a lot of cases where a lot of people have gone out to help, and coordinating that is kind of tricky, making sure that we're not missing gaps and that we're making sure that we hit a lot of areas. On some of the more advanced machines that are just now coming out, from my laptop, I can control 5 machines and set up a big search pattern and let them all go. That's not necessarily any better because you really need to have someone watching every monitor. So it doesn't really save the manpower, but it does help on the planning side. When I'm going out and I have 8 or 10 guys who are all, you know, passionate about trying to find, you know, someone's lost cat, well, it becomes very tricky because you don't want to miss anything, but you got to make sure that you have enough overlap. So it is challenging because not everyone on a situation like that will have the same machine. And so you can't just, okay, you take this part of the map, you take this part, and everyone automates it so it's nice and clean. It doesn't always work that well. So it can be dicey when you have a lot of people out all trying to help on something. I appreciate it. I love it when a community gets together and really goes after, you know, a particular situation. We've had a number of them in the past few months where we've had 6-8 guys all go out and try and help and throw every resource they have at trying to find somebody. So I love it, and I love that people are doing that together, but it is challenging, and you need somebody who has the skills to coordinate it. Okay, what's the altitude that we typically fly at with thermal cameras? And, well, anytime we're doing kind of these search and rescue missions, regardless of daylight or thermal, we're generally in the 100 to 150 feet above ground level. That's giving us enough width that we don't have to make a lot more passes, and it's close enough that we're able to differentiate different heat sources with detail. So if I'm too far away, I might not be able to tell the difference between a person and a deer. So I gotta have enough detail to be able to say, to exclude the things that are false positives, but yet high enough that, or wide enough that I don't have to make 1,000 passes and I can do it a lot more effectively. So it's always trade-offs based on your lens that you choose. Vegetation coverage and how that affects. So when I talk about the horse, that particular situation, they had overflown that area several times with a 3DR solo. Didn't see anything. And I got over it with a daylight camera on an Inspire, and I didn't see anything. We got over it with the thermal camera. There was a horse there. He was underneath scrub brush, and there was just no way of seeing him from the air. And until she pulled him out of that, we didn't see the horse the entire time, except on thermal. So some canopy we can see through easily. The more dense and the more moisture content in that material, the more difficult it's gonna be to see through. So water is the big barrier to thermal, right? It's a wall. So fog, high humidity, water, you know, and if I have a heavy leafed plant that has a lot of water in that structure, it's gonna be more difficult to see through than scrub brush, which is thick, but it's very, very dry. So we were able to penetrate that extremely easily with the thermal camera. So different, it's hard to just give you a blanket answer that works, but does that explain it well? Rainforest is gonna be a little tricky with the thermal. You're gonna have days where it's gonna be amazing, and it's gonna just blow your mind, and you're gonna have days that you're just like, why did I wake up? LiDAR is a little different. Now you've got, LiDAR is using a laser system to go in. It doesn't have any penetration, but you have much greater detail. So it's gonna be fantastic for 3D mapping, but not for search and rescue stuff when you're trying to get through canopies. It has zero penetration through that. Okay, so the question is, when we're doing a big search pattern, and if we get outside of visual line of sight, how are we doing that legally, and how do we deal with terrain, right? I never do anything illegal. So, there's that, right? The problem that we face today in COAs and exemptions and everything is the process is horrible. So I can go and file an exemption to say these GPS coordinates for the next year I can fly at, and that will extend 3 kilometers. How do I cover my entire county? So I can't. It's not feasible. Coming soon will be the system that will allow for emergency waivers. And that is supposed to be instantaneous. We will see. We are talking about the government here. So efficiency and government generally don't go together. But I'm hopeful because it has to happen. How do I get an emergency exception to fly at night? For just as a simple example. So that has to come. Oh, and the terrain, so there's a couple different situations today. So MapPilot, which is one that I use the most, actually has an option for terrain following, which is basically just using existing topographical maps. So I gotta be very careful in using that some structure isn't now there that wasn't on the topo that it's using. The upcoming MG1 from DJI has a downward facing microwave radar system to do terrain following. And that's definitely going to be an improvement because it's not based on some historical data. And so I'm looking forward to seeing how well that works. And as we always see, product features like that start at the very high end and very, very quickly work their way down into the type of things that we can afford. And so I'm looking forward to seeing how well that downward facing microwave radar works. That's a great question, actually. So he's asking, how do we manage when, you know, some dad with a drone decides to go be a hero and go find someone he saw on the news, and how do we manage these aircraft that are out there? And there's actually a solution that's in process and is getting better. Right now, it's a little tricky, but in a typical situation like that, what the correct process would be is you would file basically for a temporary no-fly zone for that area. Then the current crop of machines that are out and that are hitting the market will actually, in real time, pull down that information and not let you fly there. So it will restrict you from entering that no-fly zone, even though it's just a temporary one. So that's that does require live internet access and some other capabilities that there's definitely some nuances to how well that's going to work, but it's the only solution that is practical. So as you file that temporary no-fly zone, the people who are authorized to fly there can bypass it. Everyone else gets blocked by even entering the area. That's the next step that we're looking at right now. Yeah. That's going to be DJI equipment with the Zenmuse XT. Yeah, because that software completely talks to that and integrates with it. Yeah. Okay, sure. So, how many of you understand the Part 107 thing? Wow, that's really impressive. I wasn't expecting that many people. In the past, you know, like pre-last week, right, you had to have a Section 333, you had to have a private pilot's license, you had to have a COA, you had to have an SOP, you had to have insurance, you had to have all kinds of stuff in order to work with a public agency, right? That was very difficult for us to deal with in terms of volunteers, right? It was damn near impossible. And so that was a very limiting factor. Now today, we have Part 107, which covers civil use, it covers public agencies. Now there's some nuances to that and how it has to be put together. But really, that's my only requirement now in order to work with our sheriff's department, our fire department, and anything else. And as of today, literally today, this morning, my temporary certificate came in. So now I am legal to go out and do these operations with people. So it's definitely a step forward in helping that process, having that 107. How many of you have actually passed your 107? Nice. How many of you have failed? Yeah, I didn't think so. Okay. I didn't think anyone would actually admit to that. I'm not telling. What do they call the guy with the lowest passing score in medical school?
Doctor.
That's right. Pilot. Actually, I got a 75. So I barely scraped through. I took it on the 29th, the very first day. There was very little study material available that made any sense, and I choked on sectionals. So, you got one more right than I did. So, it's not an easy test. I mean, you got to study for it. Anyone who tells me, oh, it's just a bunch of common sense, I'm just going to go in there and ace it. Yeah, we'll talk tomorrow. Yes. So, I mean, I just went out with our sheriff's department. And they're like, can I have a copy of your license? I'm like, absolutely. you know, here you go. So I do, that's how we've worked in the past. Yeah, well, our sheriff's department doesn't. Our fire department does. They have a UAV team, and they're expanding on that. Our police department does not yet. So it's growing slowly in Colorado, but they have been very, very cautious about doing it. We've been going through it with the insurance. There's one insurance company that covers almost every single public agency in Colorado, CERSA. And so we worked with them on a training program. We're going through all this whole process. The biggest mistake that was made was by our sheriff's department. And he asked if I would go with him to all these town hall meetings so that he could get community buy-in on his UAV program, which set his UAV program back a year. Because this is one of those times it is better to ask for forgiveness than permission, because he did not get permission from the community. Mostly, yes, 80, 90%, easy, 95% probably. But the few percent that for lack of a better word, I call nutters, ruined it for him. And he was terrified. When you're going into a meeting with about this many people and you have some mother stand up screaming, bawling her eyes out, "I don't want anyone to film my child." Well, don't let your child go outside. What do you want from me? You got airplanes and helicopters flying over your house every day. You're in the frickin' flight path to the airport. What's the problem? But it was that approach to go out and say, "Do you mind if we do this?" Yeah, that was a big mistake. You say, "Here's our plan, here's our objectives, here's what we're gonna do, here's how we're gonna do it, here's what our privacy policy is, this is our data retention policy, this is all the pieces we have in place on how we're going to implement this," and you just tell people. And I guarantee you, you start saving a life here or there, and no one's gonna say a word. It will change public perception very, very quickly when you start having successes. Yeah. Oh, that's fantastic. And it's companies like that, which I gotta give some credit to, for even offering, A lot of them won't. There's liability, there's, responsibility issues. But because you have the gear, why not help, right? What you have to do is work with your local agencies. The biggest problem that I see facing this whole situation is communication. Right? So I have my fire department, which is literally across the street from my store, who has all the technology, all the equipment sitting there on standby 24 hours a day, and yet a 70-year-old guy 20 miles away goes missing in the mountains, and a week later I get a phone call saying, "Can you help find my daddy?" He would have been found. They didn't make the call. They didn't call. They have an agreement that they will go out and help them, and no one called them because they didn't know. The people who are on scene simply didn't know to call Castle Rock Fire and ask for help. Unless you are part of the team, or you are part of the process, it does me no good for you to call me a week after someone's been missing in the snow. That's not a rescue mission. That's a recovery mission. Yeah, go ahead, please. Yeah.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
I say absolutely yes. There is no question in my mind that you could be a huge asset to situations like this. It's working with the departments. It's getting that relationship down. It's them having that trust that you can be an asset to them instead of a detriment during a crisis like that. But I definitely think you can. And I wish you all the best in doing that, because you have an amazing opportunity to make a difference. Correct. Yes. Now, what I'm seeing is that the agencies are pre-vetting the people that they're going to work with. So I have a long history of working with our fire department. I have a short history of working with our sheriff's department, but they know they can trust me. Yeah. Right. Right, and our sheriff's department has a training program. So if you want to volunteer to work in rescue operations with our sheriff's department, they have a specific training for that. So yeah, hold on, I'm gonna go to the guy in the back here. He's gonna pass out from having his hand up for so long. In the overall communication?
Like the cellular communication with drone employee or other apps.
Oh, okay. Right now, we're only just starting to see aircraft that work off LTE. And that, to me, that's no. The lag is going to be horrific for a while. Being able to have a communications, voice communications stuff with everybody else is critical. So there's a number of different aspects in here that I'm trying to narrow down what it is you actually are trying to ask me.
It makes it operate in the wilderness where you're deep and you're away from any connectivity.
Mm-hmm.
Do these systems make it operate?
Oh yeah, I don't need any cellular data or anything for the systems to operate. It's a peer-to-peer connection from the transmitter to the copter. So I don't rely on anything external to that. The only real difference being, if I need to do that mapping or set up a grid, I'll need to see that map. Now I can either preload it if I know that I'm going to go to a particular place, or I just kind of have to fake it once I'm there, or hope I have enough data signal to bring up the map so I can draw the area in order to map it. Most of the time they're being flown manually, because you have a general idea, or you can manually do a search path. So you don't need to do an automated map every time or an automated search every time. If you do, that's when a data connection is handy to actually bring up a map and overlay your grid on top of it. Okay. So is there any groups that are trying to bring all this information and people together? And yes, there are. There's Swarm as one. There's a couple others that are trying. Anytime that you're working with such a diverse group of agencies and people and government regulations, imagine the pain that we're all going through trying to bring this all together. There's a couple of groups that are trying to have the pilots as a resource that anyone can call on. There's others that are the other agencies that there's no possible way they will ever deal with that, because they want to know the people that they're working with and really know that they're capable of doing it and how they interface with that agency. I mean, I know how to work with our fire department, I know how to work with our sheriff's department, but some other department, you know, in the state may operate completely differently, and I get there with my experience with the agencies I work with and it may not be relevant. So it's that whole piece of it is going to be very difficult. But I think as we go and as the different agencies work with more and more pilots, that will kind of standardize over time. What was the second piece? The best way to start it? Start local. You know, get it. You know, to me it was easy. They came into my store. I didn't have to search out the fire department or the sheriff's department. They literally walked into my store. So that was easy. But now reaching out to more and more and more, it's a challenge, because some are very receptive, some are extremely against it. And so there's this other challenge of educating the different departments on capabilities, features, benefits. You know, most of them are getting it and now they're starting to look at it. But I say you have to develop that relationship with your local departments. Maybe go out and do some demos, show them what the capabilities are so that they can start seeing the benefits. Yeah, so there's a lot of that I agree with there, and I believe that's also going to be very situational in different areas, right? Well, you say don't try and work with the police, right? Right. So, I'll speak to the Colorado situation. Right. We have five different agencies. We have police, sheriff, fire departments. I guess four. And some cities have outsourced search and rescue teams. Right. And I work with, you know, every one of these I'm working with. So with police, that's very situational, right? Our local police deal with crime and such, and in that case, they're sometimes looking for people, but very rarely. Usually it's, you know, there's someone hiding, there, you know, it's a crime investigate thing going on. Our fire departments mostly deal with search and rescue, except for the ones that have the outsourced ones. And our sheriff also deals with some search and rescue, especially in the unincorporated areas, wildfires, and all auto accidents. So they want to get up, take a picture, come down, and then clear the scene, do all the measurements after the fact. So they all have specific UAS uses. There's a little bit of overlap on each one, but for the most part, they're very specific in what their jobs are. Oh yeah, we rarely see two different departments on the same thing, right? I can only think of two situations in the last year where multiple agencies were together, and it was every one of them involved an officer shooting. So everyone, that's all hands on deck. So, yeah.
Oh, please, talk to him later.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think there's a lot of ways of solving the problems, and it's all going to come together. I wish we could have gone longer. Thank you all for coming.